Salaam alaikum, peace and blessings be upon you. I wanted to touch on two examples of visiting Palestine that might help you to reflect on the issue at stake. When I landed, as I said, into Palestine, the very first thing you could see was just the amount of security infrastructure, and it was directed at, if you will, Palestinians. And at times, like here in the US, at times, like when you're going through security, you're taking off your shoes, you're putting them through, if you will, the X-ray machine, and you get to a certain point where, like in the, how do you say, like past the security point where now you went through the security check-in, and so now you can move around, you can go around the gates near the airport. Now you've already went through your security, if you will. That's not how it is when you go through an Israeli checkpoint. It's not like you go, I'm just trying to give you, it's the worst example I can think of, but I'm just trying to think about it as in the airport where there's one location where you go past security and then you could move around. And here the example I'm referring to is when I went to visit, if you will, Hebron. When I went to visit Hebron, if you will, and I had relatives there, I wanted to visit the Ibrahimi Mosque. It was Friday prayer, and I wanted to go and see it. I did not feel comfortable taking my daughter with, given the experiences of travel via taxis, where anytime they stop, you see them, you know, heavily armed, you know, with machines and submachine handguns, guns, and you're just always kind of on edge if they're going to be provoked, you know, like, because they're always like anything provokes them, you're always worried that they're going to be provoked. So I asked my relatives if they could watch my daughter, and I went with my nephew and my niece. And we met my niece close to the mosque. I started off with my nephew going there. And you go through a checkpoint, they harass and harass again. And the way they harass is they mock his haircut. They mock the way he's dressed. He was around 14 to 15 years old. They mock his shoes. So they start, it's that issue, it's that mentality of, if you will, like not that there's a security issue, but there's an attempt to provoke and then shoot, provoke and then beat you up. And so they start, and you're just like telling him to just stay calm and don't say anything. And so you walk through that checkpoint, you breathe a sigh of relief. But it's not like, as I mentioned beginning, where you go through the airport security and then you're kind of free, you can go and buy coffee in the lobby area where those stores are at, and then go to the gates and now you could kind of like breathe a sigh of relief, it's over. No. And then there's another checkpoint. You go through that checkpoint and they do the same thing. They start to harass and they start to attack and they start to bash and they start to, and if you stay calm, you know, they get really irritated. It's not like they get happy. They're saying, oh, you know, they're not going to fight us back. And they start even like thinking about more creative ways that they could harass you. So you go past that one. And then you go through this X-ray machine. And then you keep going. So there's like, I lost count, but there's so many checkpoints. And these soldiers, like at any time, they can just jump in your face and say, give me your ID. So they can ask for your identification and they can just take their time looking at the ID and trying to like ask dumb questions, if you will, making up stuff just to harass you, just to annoy you, just to aggravate you. You go past that and then they will just make up anything that ticks them off, even though you've went through all these checkpoints and it was fine. And someone will come in and they'll feel like, you know, I just don't feel like, you know, I'm going to let you go into the mosque. We got very close to the mosque, very, very close. And they made a decision that they were not going to let the men go in. It's not all of the men, but some of the men. So they went ahead and started telling them to go stand in the hot sun. So they have this place where sometimes when you're driving in the taxi or when you're going anywhere, you'll see these men, and sometimes they're handcuffed, or sometimes they're just standing right there in the hot sun. And while the soldier claims that they're trying to investigate something. And so as you went, you know, you were deciding what to do, should you go in or what, your nephew told you to go and just pray, and then he'll just be waiting here. So you went in, you prayed, you came out with your niece. They started to harass again. There was that harassment again. There were many checkpoints, even up the stairs, into the mosque. And as soon as you come out, they're still plotting and planning to harass. One of the things that I noticed when you're going up the stairs and they're checking you again, and they're checking you another time, a few steps ahead, just checking you again, is how many soldiers were on the rooftops. There were just so many soldiers with machine guns on the rooftops. And these soldiers, they took, if you will, just to get, like, to try to, like, provoke you. And they're not able to, they get, like, kind of antsy. They get kind of upset. There was this cat, like, that was just walking in the street. And they wanted to, like, show their display of power. And they started to shoot at the cat. And they would use expletives like, you know, sharmuta, sharmuta at the cat. And they would laugh as they were shooting at the cat. And, you know, you were like, you know, shocked, like the amount of soldiers, the amount of guns, the amount of checkpoints that was all around the area that is supposed to be holy, all around figures that are close to God, if you will. And so I told the soldier at the time, you know, if the prophets are standing right here and would talk with you, what would they say about your behavior? Abraham was right here, and because the place is the place where the prophets are buried. Abraham is buried there, Sarah is buried there, Isaac is buried there, Jacob is buried there. So this is a place which is very holy for Muslims and Jews as well. And so I asked him, you know, if the prophets, they came up and they're like, they're looking at you and what you're doing, what would they say about your actions right now? And I guess they did not think about that type of question being posed at them. And so they were looking at me like, you know, they were thinking about an us versus them. And you're like, you know, Abraham is buried here, and supposedly you love Abraham. Do you really think that Abraham would be happy with what you're doing right now and your actions and how you're treating the children of Ismail? Would he be happy of how you're treating them? And he didn't know, again, what to say. But he just looked at me like kind of like he was not expecting that question. So you went further down, and then you went, and they started again, another set of soldiers, and they started to harass, this time your niece. And you started to argue with, if you will, the soldier and say, you know, why are you harassing my niece? And as you were arguing with the soldier, an older man comes and he pushes you. And he's like, you know, just go, just go, just go. They're going, if you keep, like, this is what they want. If you do that, they will come and they will use that as a means to attack you. And then they will claim that you had a knife and you tried to stab them or attack them. So you kept pushing me from the back to go. You caught up with where your nephew was standing, and you went and stood there with him in the sun, just trying to, if you will, comfort him, trying to just stand there in solidarity with him. And they finally felt like they had, you know, they couldn't do much, so they let us go. But the one thing I want to stress about that experience was, none of these times was there anyone that threw rocks at them. that called them names, that yelled at them, that bashed them, that said anything negative. People were walking peacefully and they were trying to disturb the peace. They were trying to provoke. They were trying to attack. They were trying to instigate. And every time they failed, they would try something more creative to the point, as I said, that literally they started shooting at cats. And they started to shoot and shoot and shoot. And they weren't aiming to target it, but just to scare it and frighten it. And laughing, they were doing it from the top of the roof, and also the soldiers on the ground. So, I mean, you're hearing cries and claims of security, 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 but how do you reconcile such behavior under claims of security? Now, it was very difficult for me to watch this because when you watch something live, it's different than when you're seeing a video on social media. So I knew that there were UN observers in the Hebron area. So I went and contacted them. I found out their information and I immediately contacted them. And it turns out that there were observers there at that time and they had recorded everything. And they said, yes, this is exactly what they also saw and witnessed. So I asked them for a report. They're called the temporary international presence, if you will. Now, recently in 2019, Israel suspended the Hebron observers and the US blocked the UN move to condemn Israel's decisions to shut them down because they don't like not only investigations, they don't want observers, they don't want cameras, they don't want witnesses. And it doesn't go well with, if you will, the claim of security. Usually when people are insecure, one of the things that you will notice about people who are genuinely insecure, like they're feeling a threat and a fear, is they want investigations. You'll say that they'll want investigations. They'll want observers. They'll want cameras. They'll want people to witness what's happening to them. That's usually people who are insecure because usually that insecurity also is coupled with invalidation, distortion, abuse, and you need, and anytime you try to tell your story, someone's out there trying to distort and attack, and you need someone to witness it. You need somebody to observe it. You need someone to record it so that you could say, look, I'm not making this up. Yet, if Israel is claiming that it wants security, you would think that they would be fighting for these things on the ground. And they would be fighting for observers, UN observers, independent observers. They would be fighting for investigations. But we're not seeing Israel fighting for these things. They're actually shutting them down. And the US comes and blocks a UN move to condemn that decision. So it seems problematic and it does not reconcile. Like their story, the Israeli story, is just not reconciling with itself. And the U.S. story or the U.S. support of wanting peace or claims to want peace is also not reconciling. Instead of saying, you know, we need U.N. observers there, they come and they block the U.N. move to condemn Israel's decision to shut down the observers. Now, these observers were part of the Oslo Accords. Part of the Oslo Accords was to have observers so that they can go ahead and see what is happening and report on it. Now, one of the issues, though, of these observers is that they cannot report to the world. Like, for example, they cannot take, like, B'Tselem, the human rights organization, the Israeli human rights organization, they cannot take a video and send it on social media. What they can do is do a report, and that report goes to Israel and the United States. And as you have seen, whatever Israel says, the United States just goes ahead and stamps and approves. But even at that level, like when I came back and I asked them, can I get a report? And they said, we cannot give you a report. They went ahead and said, yes, what you witnessed is what we witnessed. What you experienced is what we witnessed, but they could not give me a report. And it seemed really quite ridiculous that I am not able to get a report and they can only give it to Israel and the United States. Like, what can come out of that report going to Israel and the United States. They just will decide to ignore it. And exactly that's what they have done. And now, and as I said, in 2019, around February of 2019 or before then, they made a decision to go ahead and even remove the observers, even though they were not allowed to speak to the world community. And the US blocked UN attempt to condemn regarding the Hebron monitors. So this is one issue that I wanted to mention. It's that the excessive amount of soldiers for just a few hundred fanatical settlers that are American. Majority of them are American. And so we're talking about creeping Sharia, but we're not talking about Americans and their creeping, if you will, I don't know what, I don't want to call it Judaism, but creeping Zionism and fanaticism that is implanted in Arab towns. We're not addressing that. So there's a lot of projection going on here, right there. There's also the soldiers that they provoke, they instigate, they want rebellion, they want protests, they want a reason so that they can go ahead and their gradual ethnic cleansing campaign can speed up a bit. They already have these strategic plans, there's deliberate plans, and they're just looking for any opportunity to speed things up, any opportunity to create some issue or some event, if you will, so that they can go ahead and do a mass expulsion or destroy this part of the street or take this land or take this particular home. And so they're always instigating. And you saw that when you were there. The youth are constantly being harassed, particularly the male youth. They're constantly being harassed at a very young age and instigated and harassed and instigated. And that's why I like the film by Obeida, where he mentions about how he just went to shop and how they took him and arrested him. And this is something that I said, like I saw with my nephew, their attempt to constantly provoke and arrest these youth. And so they instigate, if you will, or they nurture in them, or they implant in them an association a rebellion, if you will, to protest what is happening, because a person can take it so much. You know, after a while, like myself, I was just looking at it and you were horrified. And people are not telling you to fight back or yell or throw. They're like, stay quiet because they'll shoot. Stay quiet, they'll shoot. They're all over the place. They'll just shoot. And this is literally what people are telling you because of the amount of feelings of fear, but also in, not being protected. The other case that I wanted to mention was a case when I had to go back to the airport to leave back to the US. And you found, you know, this taxi driver, you know, relatives helped me find a taxi driver, was allowed to get it through the into proper Israel. And so you went into prehistoric Palestine, if you will. And you went to the, as you're driving into the airport again, the checkpoint stop, the taxi, and they order us to get out. It was like very breezy, early in the morning, around again, before dawn. And your plane is going to be leaving in a couple of hours. And so you're thinking that, you know, you have time, but you're always kind of at their mercy if they let you go or not. So they check, they see nothing is in the car. You know, they see nothing is on the taxi driver. But the lady felt like, you know, it was an Israeli lady soldier, and she felt like she wanted to have a cigarette break. She ordered all of us to sit outside. It was very cold. And she just sat there and had a cigarette break. And as you were trying to explain to her that you have to catch your plane because of you're worried that you will not be able to go or catch it on time, she just kept looking at you with a very callous look and just smoking her cigarette. And the taxi driver just said, you know, just play it cool because this is just meant to like get you to say something so that they can like shoot or attack. And so there's this nonstop continual attempt to provoke, to instigate, to display their power over you, to subjugate, to humiliate. So you felt it at there, and you looked at the guy's, you know, face, because you could see the humiliation in the face that he, after a certain time, like I experienced this in that 2.5 weeks, and it left you feeling, in a sense, as you're leaving, guilt that you're able to escape this, and your relatives and your Palestinian countrymen are not able to. And so you're feeling, you're coming to that filth and to that feelings of guilt, and you're looking, you know, at his face, and you're seeing the traumatized, if you will, the impact of the trauma of having to deal with this over time, that they just sort of become not just subdued, but exhausted from the nonstop harassment, the nonstop beatings, the nonstop imprisonment. They become exhausted. They become tired. It becomes very difficult to keep fighting this day after day, experiencing it day after day. And that was where, like, if you could scan the face and describe it, those were like some of the feelings that I felt as you were just sitting there. And she just refused to let us move. And then finally, when he just kept telling me, just stay quiet, don't say anything, because this is just some of the games they play. Finally, then she went ahead and she said, okay, you can go now. But it's not like, as I said, I was trying to get across to the listeners, it's not like when you go through the U.S. security at the airport, even then, like imagine if someone started calling you names or harassing you or shooting at a cat and saying sharmuta, sharmuta, if you will, in the airport. You know, we could still file complaints about that person. We can have them removed. There would be like still some condemnation of that soldier or whoever it is at the security point making such sort of comments. Or if somebody's trying to humiliate you and you were able to record and there were witnesses, you could still go to some advocacy or civil rights group, the ACLU and others, and still point that out. That's not available there. That's not available. All these security points, one after the other, they feel such impunity and such, if you will, like the superpowers have their back, whatever they do, that it's, you can see the intoxication, the power intoxication that's in their minds and that's in their being, like when they speak with you, like they feel comfortable to attack you and say whatever racist thing comes to their mind. Without any fear, without any, if you will, consequence happening to them. And you're always at a fear. If they do something, like I mentioned, if they massacre people in the mosque, you suffer, the Palestinians suffer. If you throw a stone, the Palestinians suffer. If there's an event in China, like the Tiananmen Square massacre, Netanyahu would say, you know, we should exploit the Tiananmen Square, you know, issue or massacre that was happening while all world attention is there and you know, engage in mass expulsions of Palestinians. So there's these plans, these strategic plans, and there's this attempt to instigate and provoke the speeding up of these plans that are now moving gradually. And they're just waiting to be executed at a faster speed, and so that they can immediately defend the plans by saying you did this or you did that. What they're not saying is that there are attempts to nonstop provoke, nonstop instigate, nonstop look for events, even if it's not within Palestine, outside of Palestine, to massively execute these plans and execute mass expulsions of the Arabs. So this is something that is very important for us to reflect on when we are questioning and when we are engaging with Palestinians, The issue is not complex, but the voices of Palestinians have been silenced and distorted and invalidated and twisted for so long, for 73 years, that there's a lot of, if you will, frustration and legitimate anger because they're getting tired. They're tired of the projection. They're tired of the propaganda. They're tired that every time they have to speak, they have to spend 95% of the time responding to the projections and the propaganda and the twisting and the distorting of their narrative. It's important that if we are genuine in speaking and genuine in listening on this discussion, that we give ample opportunity for the Palestinians to speak and tell their narrative according to the lived experiences in their own words, without the grueling and the interrogations and the and putting them on the prosecution stands for crimes that they did not commit. So I thank you for listening, and I hope those two examples have helped you understand that the issue is not an issue of security for Israel. We can understand how people who are insecure act and how they wish to gain security. This is not an issue of security. This is an issue of rationalizing and justifying an ethnic cleansing campaign that's been set in motion for 73 years and looking for every opportunity to increase the speed of its mass execution. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.